BAPSA for inviting me to this talk. And it's a little intimidating for me because being a student here, we're not used to welcoming students in public talks here, but well, it's a challenge I hope to live up to. I'll begin my presentation and my talk here by reminding us all of a very important article which had been written by, I don't think this is on. This article had appeared in the Guardian in 2010, December 2010. It was called The Death of Universities by Terry Eagleton. What Eagleton was writing about is that there is a tendency in the stages of advanced capitalism to denude the study of humanities in universities. And Eagleton had a very nuanced understanding of what he means by humanities. It is not necessarily people who study humanities, people who study social sciences. And in fact, he urged students who study science and, IT and engineering, etc., they should also have some smattering of what humanities is all about. And it is an understanding and a study of values which will help us challenge the status quo. Things like justice and human rights. And his argument was that in advanced capitalism, universities, the study of humanities is discouraged in universities for obvious reasons, because advanced capitalism does not want us to question the status quo. And universities being the disreputable sites where these questions arise, so there would be a conspiracy of advanced capitalism to discourage the pursuit of humanities in universities. And this is exactly what we are seeing today, in today's regime, fascist regime in India. And the discouragement of studying humanities happens through many ways. So one thing which Eagleton wrote about was that his understanding of humanities is that it's not just in what we study, in what we research, but it is also about adopting a critical faculty in universities, about challenging the establishment, about questioning the powers that be. And this dichotomy between academics and activism, that you are supposed to train yourself into a certain kind of academics which helps you to be on good terms, in good books with the establishment. That is the agenda of the fascist government today. And since today we are remembering Rohith, Rohith Vemula was one of those students who challenged this conspiracy to dissuade students from asking those questions. If we remember the series of events which had happened in HCU, which led to the expulsion of Rohith and his four other comrades, the series of events which shows that how Rohith dared to hold events or to hold events or protests, things which challenged the state in which we are living today. That is exactly what prompted the MHRP to take actions against him, which ultimately led to his suicide, which we know is an institutional murder. So that kind of activism is now discouraged in universities, and it is not just done through the state coercing students to take their own lives. It is also done, as we know, through regulations such as the Lingdo Committee regulations, which have been passed a few years ago, which show that students should enter universities only to train themselves into a certain kind of academics which is conveniently divorced from activism. So that you can, you can train yourself into, social science or whatever field of study, but you do not question the status. You do not question the establishment, or you do not question the state which exists. And I think social justice, in realizing social justice in universities would be to challenge this rabbinical conspiracy of divorcing activism from academics, of retaining the spirit of humanities within universities like JNU and XU, so that at least we can retain that kind of questioning that universities should enshrine. The interesting thing is that if the institutional murder of Rohith was supposed to be an intimidation for students who dare to scream Muzaffarnagar Baki Hai, or who dare to question the carceral state, which, you know, which sends a person like Yaqub Memon to the gallows. If that is what is the agenda of, that is one of the agendas of the fascist state which we are living in today. But that's not it. Universities will, fascism in universities will also, you know, forcibly disappear students for just being there. You don't even need to open your mouth and question fascism, or you don't even need to do radical things to threaten the establishment. You just need to be present. And that is what the imposed disappearance of Nazir Ahmad shows. He was just a student in this university perhaps for 2 weeks. He was relatively unknown to everyone in this campus. He hardly had any friends. He doesn't have many relatives as well. And what is essentially tragic about the disappearance of Najib, because since many of us have been part of the protests which followed after his disappearance, is that whenever his mother would be present among us, and whenever his mother would, you know, lament the disappearance of her son, she would go on to say that if Najib were to be found, she will, you know, take him back to Badaun, his hometown, and that she intensely regrets that he ever came to study in JNU. And I don't know how many of us gave her that assurance that actually that will be, you know, accepting defeat if Najib were to go back to Badaun and not continue with his education. Because that is exactly what the fascist state wants. That students belonging to marginalized identities, students coming from Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi, Muslim backgrounds should not be present in universities. And that is where you realize the scary intensity of fascism in India today. You don't even, you know, you just need to be present there in universities for the fascist order to be threatened. And that brings us to the importance of mechanisms of social justice in universities. That brings us to the importance of the Rohith Act. That brings us to the importance of the recommendations of the Thorat Committee and other committees which have given a lot of recommendations to improve social inclusion in universities, to allow universities to have an increased presence of students hailing from marginalized communities. Because knowledge, after all, is power. You can empower yourself, your children, through the pursuit of knowledge. And you can turn that empowerment into a note of dissent against the establishment only if you are allowed to question. So in order to realize that space in a university which allows marginalized students to enter universities and at the same time to not become, you know, to not become beings in which consent is manufactured, to retain that spirit of dissent for which universities, to retain the question, the spirit of questioning and, you know, casteist, Brahminical, fascist orders. For all these objectives, social justice is required in universities. And we have to seriously introspect about how far the extant regimes, admission regimes, recruitment regimes, and supervised allotment regimes allow that kind of institutional mechanism in universities like JNU. A couple of days ago, I was going through the findings of the Abdul Nafi committee report, and it clearly shows that for several years, the performance of SC/ST OBC students for the viva during the entrance to MPhil and PhD programs, it has been consistently downgraded compared to students belonging to upper caste backgrounds. Now, it clearly shows that even though these students are performing relatively better in the written exams, when they appear for the viva, there is an inherent prejudice which is executed against them. And so this is the reason why we have been demanding that marks for the viva should be reduced, so that the prejudice which marginalized students face at the time of just entering the university, that prejudice can be diminished. But this is not enough. It's not enough to simply, it is extremely essential for the viva to be reduced. But then in order to turn a university from an alienating space into a space which is accommodating for everyone, we need to go a step beyond and see that the affirmative action is not a favor which the state does to SCST OBC students. It is not a favor which Brahminism has done to us. We do not owe gratitude to Brahminical systems in this country that we have got SCST OBC students. We don't. It is a right. And it is a hallmark of a free university which respects dissent and the critical culture to give these to give reservations and to allow an egalitarian admission structure to students coming from marginalized communities. At the same time, we must remember that the whole argument of good research, that itself, it's very important to do good research, because we know that fascism will always felicitate a person like Appara, who is a murderer, who is a Brahmin asshole. So it is the hallmark of fascism to give a felicitatory recognition to some academic achievement which he may have done. It is the nature of fascism to give academic recognition to someone like Abhijit Chakravarti, who we know had overseen a lot of shit which happened in Jadavpur University in 2015. So in that case, in order to defeat fascism's conspiracy to give recognition to people who plagiarize, people who have no idea of what good research means, we should ensure that for our part, we do not compromise on our academics. And this is something, I'm hitting on a very personal note here, because for me, academics and activism both matter a lot. Because as I said, it is the conspiracy of advanced capitalism in the form of fascism to defeat the project of both activism and academics in universities. So in order to resist that conspiracy, we need to ensure that not only our arguments for social justice are retained, but we also need to make sure that we do not use those arguments to produce bad research. And coming to the point of activism and student politics, since I've been involved in a lot of activism in this university since last year, a lot of these vocabularies which we have in student politics, a lot of these arguments are based on unity. That unity is the need of the hour, and we have different definitions of unity. But I'm a little uncomfortable with the politics of unity. I'd much prefer the politics of solidarity. Because when you give solidarity to someone, you recognize that that person is different from you. That person may not share your own identity, that person may not share your own background, that person will not share your own ideology. But you will give solidarity, because when fascism raises its head, it's a collective, it's going to affect everyone. Certain identities for sure, but yes, it's a danger for everyone. So if we need to ally across identities, we need a politics of solidarity. And perhaps we have achieved some kind of politics of solidarity against that leftist rhetoric of unity which we are always fed. That the moment you express dissent, you are breaking unity, you are a unity breaker. But then, if we are to resist that kind of unity which is shoved down our throats, we need to have some kind of politics of solidarity in which we can respect differences. in which we can respect that I can differ from you, but I will still give you my solidarity. And this is where I'm going to make a rather contentious claim that most identity politics ultimately devolves into the search for a pure victimhood. That I am Muslim, so I am the greater victim. I am a Dalit, so I am the greater victim. It is, you know, the conspiracy of Brahminism to actually instill these ideas into our heads. But only if we recognize that both of us are equally, at the end of the day, affected by, vulnerable to Brahminism. Only then can we enunciate some kind of politics of solidarity. And that is the hope of student activism in universities like JNU. And that is the hope which some of us have from new organizations which are emerging, which have, you know, emerging in JNU and challenging the existing status quo. Because, and I need to make this point, that it is a Brahminical conspiracy to divorce activism from academics. But then if we are to refute this conspiracy, and if we are to reinstate the importance of an activism which is informed by academics, and an academics which is informed by activism, then we need to make sure that we enunciate this politics of solidarity. We enunciate this acceptance of mutual vulnerability. Victimhood. Yesterday we did have a march in memory of Rohith, in which we avowed to reject victimhood and reclaim resistance. So if we are to reclaim resistance, we have to reject these particularistic notions of victimhood and recognize a mutual vulnerability. Because that is the only hope which we can have for student politics in JNU. I'm sorry, I've digressed from social justice to talk a little bit about activism, but I've done this under the belief that we can't really have social justice if we are all to sink into non-activist modes of existence in universities. Because as we remember, Rohith Vemula himself was a very strident activist in HCU. And I see his institutional murder as the ultimate price some of us have to pay. I don't know, it's a needless price, but a price which he had to bear for expressing a very radical notion of what solidarity may mean, of asking very radical questions which the fascist state in India is unable to stomach. And I think if we are to remember Rohith every day, not just on 17th and 18th of January, but if we are to remember him every day, what we can hope is that we can offer solidarities across identities, but from a position of recognizing the communitarian belonging from which we come. There is a strand of politics in JNU which espouses that you reject your communitarian belonging. And I have strong disagreements with that kind of politics. But I still believe that we can, express solidarities while at the same time recognizing individual communitarian identities, be it the Dalit or a Muslim or Adivasi or anything else. And if we are to, so social justice in universities and reimagining what the university would be like would be a space where students are not discriminated on the basis of their identities at the time of entering universities. So you would need legal mechanisms for that. You would need to enact the Rohith Act. You would need to implement minority deprivation points. You would need a host of mechanisms like reduction of viva voce marks. And after those have been realized, we would also need to introspect upon our own vocabularies of resistance. Because after all, social justice in universities means a humanities in which a student is both an academic and an activist. So for that, there is a stronger resistance, I think, which is needed to confront the fascist state, because it's not going to give us our rights easily. And as we know, according to the recent UGC guidelines, there is a host of measures which will not just curb the activist potential, but also the academic potential of students. Students, if it's implemented, then students will remain without research supervisors in the MPhil and PhD levels. Students coming from marginalized backgrounds will not be able to enter universities because the Viva Voce has been converted from our demand of reducing it, it's been converted into 100% Viva weightage. So, the only way to resist all that is to build and to intensify the movement which we have today. And I'll just conclude with this one fact, which while we were all resisting, while protesting against the disappearance of Najib, we remember that, I mean, we had Girav, the admin block, and the JNU Teachers Association had dissuaded us from doing that because they were fearful of the fact that the university would declare sanitary, as it was done in 1983. Now, the gentleman did not tell us why the university was declared sanitary in 1983. It was because there was a professor here by the name of P.C. Saxena who had given casteist insult to a student, and the students had demanded that the professor should be suspended. But the Teachers Association did not accede to the demand, and the Vice Chancellor then was hell-bent on not giving in to the demands of the students. By the way, the movement was led by the JNU SCST Welfare Association. This was before any caste-based mobilization could even happen in universities like JNU. But the university, the Vice Chancellor, the teachers, they were absolutely hell-bent on not acceding to the demands that a casteist Brahminical professor should be removed. And that is when the students had done a girao of the admin block, which led to the university being declared sanitary for about a week. It was just from between 26th February and 2nd March 1983. And when the blockade happened, the media, as usual, went into a service of declaring JNU as a race panic. And this should remind us that what happened in October last year, when we were testing for Najib, has a history. So there is a history of casteist incidents, there's a history of Brahminical manifestations taking place in JNU, and authorities refusing to recognize that it has happened, and authorities refusing to take any action against that incident. And then when students try to take matters into their hands to do justice, we are labeled as anarchic people. So, but it should make us wonder that the authorities are always this, stubborn and unyielding institutes. Only when an occasion of social injustice happens. For example, what happened back then, a student being insulted, or what happened last year in October, that a student being lynched, and then forcibly disappeared. So universities need a lot of questioning, and students need a lot of intensification. Students should intensify student movements to make universities accountable to incidents which happen, incidents of social injustice, incidents of discrimination, incidents of, enforced disappearance, like what happened to Najib. And in order to do that, again, I reiterate, we need a kind of model of social justice which allows students to participate in a strident politics of activist politics, while at the same time being informed by academic persons as well. So what has happened in JNU has a history. I mean, I got this one random fact from a very badly written book, but that if we do a bit of reading, I'm sure JNU will be filled with such incidents where students have been insulted, where students have been stripped of their dignity, and that we need to make sure that these incidents stop. The fascist state in India perhaps gives an indication that these incidents are not going to stop, they're going to increase. 2016 was full of such incidents. And I'm not just talking of JNU and HCU. There were other incidents in smaller universities which never made it to the national headlines. There were incidents of casteist slurs and enforced institutional murders and enforced suicides happening in many universities. And the fascist state, it's the agenda of the fascist state to ensure that, to keep that up. And in order to put a stop to that, we need an intensification of a mode of protest which allows us to question the fascist state. But unfortunately, that mode of questioning is absent right now in JNU for reasons which I'm not going to go into right now. But in order to fill that lacuna, in order to replace the existing mode of activism, we need a lot of institutional mechanism. As I said, we need a new kind of imagination of student politics which does not exist right now. I don't have any other note of optimism to say, except that, well, in the future perhaps we can have that kind of vocabulary of resistance. And so I'm just saying that because I don't like to end on a note of pessimism. So yeah, I'll rest my case there. Thank you.